In our previous video, we explored how ultra-pure silicon wafers are created from sand through fascinating processes like the Zokrowski method. Today, we're taking the next exciting step in our solar energy journey, transforming those pristine silicon wafers into powerful solar cells that convert sunlight into electricity. Last time, we discovered the incredible precision required to create mirror-smooth silicon wafers. But a wafer alone cannot generate electricity. Today, we'll witness the remarkable transformation that turns a simple silicon wafer into a sophisticated photovoltaic device capable of powering our homes and cities. Welcome back to Mr. Smart. The traditional solar cell manufacturing process involves 9 critical steps, each requiring precise control of temperature, chemistry, and timing. Pre-check and pre-treatment stage is the foundation of quality. Our journey begins with rigorous quality control. Each silicon wafer undergoes comprehensive inspection for geometric shape, thickness conformity, and any damages such as cracks, breakages, or scratches. Think of this as a medical examination. We need perfect health before proceeding. Just like a doctor examines a patient before surgery, we must ensure our silicon wafers are flawless. A single crack or impurity can compromise the entire solar cell's performance. Following inspection, wafers are meticulously cleaned with chemicals to remove any metal residues, liquids, or production remains that could impact efficiency. This cleaning process uses specialized chemicals designed for semiconductor applications, ensuring absolute purity. Once cleaning is done, the wafers are subjected to the most important stage called texturing. In texturing, we perform our first magical transformation. In texturing process, random pyramid textures are formed, aligned across the entire surface. The texturing is achieved through chemical etching, where the wafer is immersed in alkaline solutions like potassium hydroxide or KOH with some special additives. The regular atomic structure of monocrystalline silicon naturally forms perfect pyramids. But why it needs to be done? Smooth silicon reflects about 30% of sunlight back to space, wasted energy. The surface of silicon wafers is textured to reduce reflection losses of incident light. Texturing traps light like a maze, bouncing photons back onto the surface multiple times, dramatically increasing absorption. Once texturing is done, now it's time to reach the heart of solar cell physics with the process called diffusion. Diffusion involves the process of creating the positive-negative or PN junction. Most silicon wafers are pre-doped with boron or any trivalent dopant during ingot formation, which makes them P-type silicon wafer naturally. During diffusion, we add phosphorus or any tetravalent dopant to create a thin surface layer to create a N-layer with opposite electrical polarity. The diffusion process occurs in specialized furnaces at high temperatures, where phosphorus atoms migrate into the silicon crystal structure, creating the essential electric field that drives current generation. The PN junction creates an electric field that allows electrons to flow in one direction when sunlight hits the cell. During diffusion, phosphorus spreads not only on the desired front surface, but also around the edges and backside, creating unwanted electrical paths. We must remove these connections to prevent short circuits. That is done in our next process called etching and edge isolation. In etching and edge isolation, we do etching with the help of chemicals to carefully remove edge connections while preserving our precious PN junction. This process involves exposing their edges to etching chemicals, precisely removing the conductive phosphorus layer formed at unwanted areas. After edge isolation is done, wafers undergo acidic rinsing to remove any post-texturing particle remains. The acid cleaning process is technically called as polishing. Using hydrogen fluoride or HF, we etch away oxidized silicon layers, while hydrogen chloride or HCl removes metallic residues by absorbing them into chloride compounds. Following etching, wafers undergo a second thorough washing to remove etching residues. This step ensures absolute cleanliness before applying the anti-reflective coating, maintaining the pristine surface quality essential for optimal performance. Formation of anti-reflective coating is most important step towards achieving a greater efficiency with solar cells. Here's where solar cells appear blue. We apply an anti-reflective coating using silicon nitride or titanium oxide. This coating further reduces reflection from the already textured surface, increasing light absorption. The most common deposition method is plasma enhanced chemical vapor deposition, or PCVD, where gaseous coating materials are chemically transformed and deposited onto the wafer surface. The coating thickness determines the cell's final color, typically the characteristic blue of traditional solar panels. Once the anti-reflective coating is formed, our solar cell is ready to harvest power, but to actually collect those electrons, we need metallic contacts that can act as easy highways for current flow. This brings us to one of the most important and crucial steps in the entire manufacturing sequence, the contact printing process. In this process, we create the visible silver grid on the front side of the cell, the network that will carry electricity away. Using highly precise screen printing equipment, metal pastes are applied to both sides of the wafer. On the front, we use a silver paste that contains about 70 to 85% silver powder, carefully blended with glass frit and organic binders. The silver ensures excellent conductivity, while the glass frit plays a key role in etching through the anti-reflective coating, so that the silver can make intimate contact with the silicon underneath. Think of it like building the electrical highway system of the solar cell. The fine silver fingers are like small local roads, collecting current from every corner of the wafer surface, while the bus bars act like major highways, gathering current from multiple fingers and channeling it out of the cell. On the rear side, a full layer of aluminum paste is printed. This not only forms an electrical contact, but also creates what's known as a back surface field, or BSF. The BSF improves the cell's efficiency by pushing minority charge carriers away from the rear surface, ensuring that fewer electrons are lost and more power is extracted. But printing alone is not enough. At this stage, the paste is still soft and non-conductive. It must undergo a transformation. This happens in the firing process, also known as sintering. Sintering is often called the most complex and critical step of solar cell manufacturing. Inside a carefully designed belt furnace, our printed pastes are converted into solid, highly conductive contacts through a precise temperature profile. Here, chemistry meets precision engineering. We're essentially performing microsurgery at around 800 degrees Celsius, creating perfect electrical connections while avoiding any damage to the delicate silicon structure. The firing process unfolds in four distinct phases. First comes the initial heating, between 25 and 200 degrees Celsius, where solvents evaporate from the paste. Next is the burnout phase, from 200 to 400 degrees Celsius, where all organic binders are completely removed. As the temperature rises further, we enter the critical sintering peak, roughly between 400 and 790 degrees Celsius. At this stage, the glass frit melts, gently etching through the anti-reflective coating, and silver particles fuse together to create a robust conductive path. Finally, during the cooling phase, as the temperature drops from around 800 back down to 200 degrees Celsius, the contacts solidify, mechanical stresses are relieved, and the structure stabilizes. The most crucial part of this process is the peak temperature. It must be precisely controlled, usually around 780 to 800 degrees Celsius. If the temperature is too low, proper contacts won't form, and the solar cell will suffer from high resistance. If it's too high, the metal may penetrate too deeply into the silicon, causing shunting and irreversibly damaging the device. By the end of this sintering journey, our once soft and lifeless metal pastes have been transformed into strong, low-resistance contacts that are firmly bonded to the silicon wafer. With this, the solar cell is finally equipped to efficiently collect and deliver the sunlight it captures as usable electricity. Now that the solar cell is complete, it must prove its worth through rigorous testing. Under standard test conditions, 1,000 watts per square meter of irradiance, a cell temperature of 25 degrees Celsius, and an AM 1.5 solar spectrum, each cell is illuminated with a calibrated solar simulator. Just like a new car is tested on the road before delivery, solar cells are tested for their electrical performance. Engineers measure the current density, short circuit current, open circuit voltage, fill factor, and overall efficiency. Current voltage curves are plotted, revealing the unique performance signature of each cell. Only those that meet stringent criteria move forward. Finally, individual cells are interconnected into strings through a process called tabbing and stringing, where thin copper ribbons solder them together. From grains of sand to electricity-generating marvels, we've just witnessed one of modern manufacturing's most fascinating journeys. Every step, from purification to firing, requires meticulous precision, deep scientific understanding, and cutting-edge engineering. The result is a device that silently and reliably converts sunlight into clean power for more than 25 years. Next time you see solar panels glistening under the sun, remember the incredible journey hidden behind their surface. Don't forget to subscribe to Mr. Smart Engineering for more deep dives into the technologies shaping our sustainable future.